يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سورة هود is a surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in Mecca. It has great meanings. It's a surah that caused gray hair to be in the hair of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam as a result of the meanings of it. And the surah talks about nations before, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent messengers for them, for their guidance, for them to see the truth, to understand the purpose of their life. And as a result of that, people split into two groups, believers and disbelievers. And the disbelievers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them. The messengers warned them of a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if they're not obedient to Allah and His messenger. And when they turned away from the orders of Allah, when they made mockery of the messengers of Allah and the orders of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them time, then He punished them. And because of that, the same way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is established on the face of earth, except that the last messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that way different for the last messenger of Allah and for the nations after him till the day of judgment, that the entire world would not be destroyed as a result of them disbelieving in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he's the final messenger of Allah, that he would not destroy them all on the face of earth as a result of that. But rather the moment of death, and also punishment before that on individual basis, on nations, ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that never changes whatsoever. And what's waiting for the people in the hereafter is sufficient for them to bring the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their hearts. We are created and ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be obedient to Him, to worship Him alone, to fear Him alone, and to hope for the rewards from Allah. He's the most merciful, and He's also severe in punishment. And this is what we get to learn and reflecting upon the verses of the surah and the beginning of the surah before the stories are mentioned, establishing this foundation for people to see with their hearts and their own eyes the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. That everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creation of Allah. And if it's a creation of Allah, that means it's maintained, it's created, maintained, sustained its life by the creator of the heavens and the earth. And therefore, people then need to humble themselves to the Creator of the heavens and the earth and worship Him alone. Inshallah ta'ala, in this episode, continuing from the beginning of the surah, we'll go through verses number 6 to number 8. From verses number 6 to number 8 in Surah Hud. And the first verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا كُلٌّ فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ, which means, and there is no creature on earth but that upon Allah is its provision. And He knows its place of dwelling and place of storage. Allah is in a clear register. This verse came after the previous ones from the beginning to verse number 5 in the same surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the Qur'an, ordering the people to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And that the Messenger of Allah and the Book of Allah, the Qur'an, are warners to the people and also giving glad tidings to the believers, ordering them to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to repent to Him. And that this life is only a temporary enjoyment, and everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everybody will be given according to their actions in this life. Therefore, everybody shall return to Allah and is able to do all things. They believe in the hereafter, in the last day. And then, since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows the concealed and what's done apparent and physical, He's the knower of all things, then this next set of verses talks about the power of Allah, since He's the one that knows everything. He's the unknower, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows what people think about, their whims, their desires, what they do physically. They cannot hide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let alone hiding their intentions or what they think about and things of that nature. So they need to be watchful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing them, seeing what's in their hearts. And one of which is the creation of Allah, the animals, the birds. And this is something that is so obvious to every single human being, those who are intellectual. They see that these animals, they don't have intellect, they don't have reason, and still they are provided for. That life is maintained. Who's the one that is maintaining it? Who's the one that is providing for them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very clear and it's very obvious. Therefore, to build on that fact, on that belief, what? It is the matter of al-Iman, the matter of faith. For people to humble themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the ayah says, وَمَا مِن دَبَّةٍ. That means there is no dabba. Dabba is any walking creature, anything that walks on the earth. Whether it's with big legs, small legs, something that we can hear, something that we do not hear, but it comes from the meaning of something that hits the ground while it's walking. So the smallest insect, the things that we see and the things that we do not see, as long as it's walking on the face of earth, this is considered to be dabba, whether it's human beings, animals, and so on. So وَمَا مِن دَبَّةٍ, but in general, the creation of Allah, the animals, the birds, everything. وَمَا مِن دَبَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ, that is on the earth. So, and how the verse starts with وَمَا مِن دَبَّةٍ, that means there is no creature, there is no walking creature on the face of earth, unless, which gives the meaning of exclusiveness. That means all of them. There is no exception whatsoever. Whether it's the biggest of the creation of Allah or the smallest of them, they're all creation of Allah, they're all in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So none of them, unless illa عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا, unless it's upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, its provisions. And the wisdom behind mentioning عَلَى اللَّهِ first, upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, its provision, not saying its provision is upon Allah. This the order of the words like this, as we heard many times before in the verses of the Quran, gives the meanings also of the exclusiveness, that it's upon Allah, not upon anyone else. You know, human beings, they might see that one animal, is a mean for provision for another animal. You know, animals, they eat one another, or they one animal provide or bring provisions for another animal. Even when a person, he eats food and he throws it in the garbage, or, you know, falls from him, you find another creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is becomes its provisions. So a person might think that he is the provider. Of course not. Nobody is a provider in that absolute sense. We as human beings, we as creation of Allah, nothing but means to one another. But the one that is really the provider is the one that created us all. And he's the one that is able of taking that away from us. So this is a matter of belief that has to be well established in the hearts of the believers, because there are actions to be built as a result of that belief. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the provisions, it's already been written and done with 50,000 years before the creation. Where do we get to know this? This is a matter of unseen to us, ghaib. And the only way we get to know the unseen is through the protected revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there are many verses that talks about the qadr of Allah, the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote, katab maqadir, the maqadir, the all the decree of the heavens and the earth, 50,000 years before the creation. And this is also going to be explained in the next verse. So the matter is done, everything is written, but we do not know what's written, and we are ordered to take the means. And if someone with reason, with intellect, not someone that is insane, would stay behind and say, I'm not going to eat the food, I'm not going to seek provisions, and I won't take the physical means to do so, then he is called insane. He is someone that is responsible for his actions. So this is not something that we need to deal with, so that nobody would say, if everything is written, then what's the purpose of seeking provisions? No person with sanity would ever say that. And the same thing should be applied with matters of the hereafter, guidance. You know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already decreed who's going to be guided or not, that means what? That means we need to act. We need to take the means of guidance. We need to not to leave ourselves like this, relying on the fact that everything is written. Nobody does that with matters of provisions. So why would they do that with matters of guidance? And that shows also how human beings, they can be contradicting to their own beliefs, and they can really fall into the path of those who are not intellectual whatsoever. So every walking creature, every creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, its provisions. And if this is for the creation of Allah, that He did not create the heavens and the earth for it, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth for the human being. So if this is for the weak creation of Allah, the animals, the birds, all of these things, then they're not going to be questioned in the Day of Judgment. Upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their provision. So how about then the human being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored? The human being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him and created everything for the human being, how would be then the provisions of the human being? It's upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why be in state of panic when it comes to provisions? Why that many of the human beings, they have to worry about the matters of provisions, earnings, what they're going to eat tomorrow, or their provisions, or their wealth, or their money? Leave the matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This heart should not be concerned whatsoever, and again without an exception, whatsoever, about matters of provisions. But the physical body should work, yes. A person should take the means and walk and run and earn and study and all kinds of means in a halal way, in a permissible way, to seek provisions. But the heart is settled, is in state of comfort and tranquility, no panicking. Many people, they might even think of taking matters in their own selves, and they would even commit suicide as a result of lack of provisions or poverty or the like of this, or become in state of depression, or they fight with each other or kill each other because of provisions in this life. The believers, they are a totally different way of understanding, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the matter clear to them. Physically, everybody is seeking provisions from Allah. So this is not going to affect the way that a person physically seek provisions, taking the means. But it makes definitely a difference physically also in the lives of the believers, because they won't seek the provisions from a haram source, from a forbidden way. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider. That means, how can then a person think that for me to be provided for, I need to seek what is forbidden by Allah, to seek the provisions that is upon Allah or from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That doesn't make sense. That's contradicting. Rather, the believers will be seeking provisions according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted for them, with their hearts strong and relying upon the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for His creation since He created them, and it's going to continue till the Day of Judgment, and it never fails. Just fear Allah, be obedient to Allah, and take the means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for you. So, illa ala Allahi rizquha, and it's upon Allah, not by being forced or something that the human beings dictated that upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Human beings or the creation of Allah, they have no power whatsoever except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can they have a say or anything? This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made upon Himself subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, out of His bounty subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards His creation. And more, to establish this belief in the power of Allah that would lead to what comes afterwards. وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider for all of His creation, and He also knows its mustaqar and mustawda. Mustaqarraha, that means its place of dwelling, the place where every single creation, where it stays, where it lives, whether it's on top of the earth or under the ground, or in the summertime it's on top of the ground, and then in the wintertime it hibernates. Where it hibernates, when it's hidden from all the human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Where it's staying, where it's homes and nests and all types of different things that are dwellings for the creation of Allah, whether it's birds or animals or anything. And He knows where it goes during the day or during the night, and where it hides and where it stays. So the word mustaqarraha, with all what it means when it comes to not moving, when it's not moving, when it's place of rest, when it's place of laying its eggs, whatever there is. And this is something that we need to witness every time we see, you know, animals and birds and how their life is. And we're living at times where we can see these matters. We don't have to travel far when, with matters of technology, we get to see the, you know, many of the creation of Allah and their lives and the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in them. And the believers, their hearts should be working when they see these types of things, and they would say, Subhanallah, that glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one that is providing for all of them. And He's the one that knows best where they stay and where they move and so on. وَمُسْتَوْدَعَ And the mustawda' of it, and its storage, meaning whether it's during its lifetime or after its death. You know, where does it stay after its death, where it's buried, how it decays, right? And what's the end of it? From the beginning till the end, nothing is hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything about that creation of Allah, from the very beginning till the end of it, everything is in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the provider of all of His creation. كُلُّمْ فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ Everything is in a clear register. By اللوح المحفوظ, by the sacred tablet, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything is written, everything. No exception whatsoever, as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created is the qalam, is the pen, and He ordered it to write everything that is going to be till the Day of Judgment, and that includes every single creation of Allah, whether it's major or small, and that shows the power of Allah, and what that necessitates in the hearts of the believers. This is something that we will see, and continuing with more of the verses after the break. So stay with us, inshallah.
محمد رسول الله محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back, and with verses in Surah Hud from verse number 6 to verse number 8. Verses that talks about the power of Allah. And when we talk about the power of Allah, we have to really realize two things. One thing is to believe in it, to reflect upon the meanings of these verses, and to believe and to make our hearts well established upon these meanings. And the second thing, because these verses are not revealed just to believe in the power of Allah, this is definitely the foundation of it, but that, and this is the way of the Quran, that would lead, as we would see in the verses, would lead to establishing the purpose of our life. What does it mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful, is the provider, is the one that is able to do all things? It means what? It leads to the fact that He is the only one worthy of worship. That people need to be obedient to Him, worship Him alone, follow the messengers of Allah, live their life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, wants from them. Otherwise, people are not then believing, as if they are not believing in the power of Allah. If they believe in the power of Allah, then they should worship Him alone, and everything is in a clear register by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next verse, verse number 7, more of the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that people see with their own eyes, and things that are hidden, unseen to them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals for people to humble themselves and to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse number 7, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَلَئِن قُلْتَ إِنَّكُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ لَيَقُولَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ Which means, and it is He who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and His throne had been upon water, that He might test you as to which of you is best indeed. But if you say, indeed, you are resurrected after death, those who disbelieve will surely say, this is not but obvious magic. So here this ayah, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ He's the creator of the heavens and the earth, and we see the creation of Allah, the heavens and the earth, but this is a matter of unseen to us, فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ In 6 days. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most powerful, the most wise. He subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things according to His will subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth. And it's mentioned in more details in other surahs of the Quran, like Surah Fussilat and others, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created His creation in 6 days. And that does not cause any tiredness or fatigue or challenges or difficulties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all the most powerful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unlike those who have distorted and deviant beliefs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needed to rest in the seventh day, wal'ayadu billah, how can that be attributed to the creator of the heavens and the earth? He created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it. Nobody is to question the wisdom of Allah. It's like someone questioning the wisdom of Allah. Why do we have air to breathe? Why can't we just live our life without breathing the air? This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created things. Of course, there's a wisdom behind it. And a great wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for human beings to be wise, to humble themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to even see that they should not rush into doing things, and there's no such a thing as from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is deficient or weakness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. في ستة أيام. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best the length or how the days are and so on. But we know from as a fact that the days to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a day to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 1,000 years in the life or the counting of the human beings. So في ستة أيام, in 6 days, وكان عرشه على الماء, and his throne had been upon water, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So we take these matters, since it's an unseen matter, we leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We understand the meanings of it, and we leave the how of it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not know how. We only know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is how human beings, they should humble themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the names and attributes of Allah, with matters of the unseen. Because again, this is it's such an obvious thing, but you know, sometimes the people, they say things that is very strange. You know, if a matter is unseen to us, that means we don't see it. How can a person then expect that he knows every single detail of it or how it is, right? People would explain things according to what they see with their own eyes. And since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of Him, that means what? That means people should not go beyond what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the Prophet without expecting or without thinking of how things are. Everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that fits perfectly the names and attributes of Allah. This is a fact, this is a matter of belief, that the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was upon water, as it's mentioned, right? There is no need to distort the meaning of it, or for someone to say it doesn't really mean this, it means something else. No, the Quran is revealed in the Arabic language, clear meanings, there is no doubt about it whatsoever. But how that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And there's a hadith, many a hadith actually, of the Prophet ﷺ, that are all authentic in Bukhari and Muslim and others, where the Prophet ﷺ mentioned this also in the hadith. That part of which is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala katab maqadir as-samawati wal-ard, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote all of the decree of the heavens and the earth, qabla al-khalq, before He created His creation, bi 50,000 alf san, by 50,000 years, wa kana arshuhu ala al-ma, and His throne was upon the water. And another narration where the Prophet ﷺ said, كان الله ولم يكن معه شيء, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was there and no one was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is al-awwal wal-akhir, He is the first, nothing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was upon water. وكان عرشه على الماء. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared to the creation of Allah is like a ring in a desert. Every heaven, seven heavens, seven skies, everyone to the one above it is like a ring in a desert, as the Prophet ﷺ said. And the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared to the last one is also like a ring in a desert. Nobody can really comprehend with their limited knowledge of what they see with their own life in this small earth that we live in. How can a person expect to comprehend the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that's why we need to limit ourselves to what has been revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ, and His throne is upon water. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. This is then after this matter of belief is established, and what's before that in the previous verses, and we need to build these meanings and to implement the outcome of these matters of belief. Why all of that is created? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, for Him to test you. And this lamb, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, in لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, it's the lamb that shows the reason why. That He might test you. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ, who among you أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا means the best indeed. So that He would test you, who among you that is the best indeed, is best indeed. Such a very clear and straightforward verse in the Quran, that this is what the human beings need to focus upon. That all of this amazing creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's created for what? for us to be tested. So we are being tested. And therefore, it's a competition that human beings, they each and every one of them should have this. And the more the person's heart is purified, the more the person elevate himself in matters of al-Iman, the more that he want to be the best among all of the creation of Allah in actions. And who's the best that has been made for us as an example and a criteria that nobody can go beyond that? And if you want to be the best, as mentioned in the Quran, you have to follow the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody will be better than him. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the best of all other human beings. And nobody will even come close to that. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to follow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in all and every aspect of life. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهُ الْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ. That indeed in the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam you have the best example. So you want to be the best in actions, follow the best among all of the human beings, which is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in his speech, in his actions, in matters of belief. And for a deed to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has to be, for it to be ahsanu amala, to be the best of deeds, it has to be akhlasu wa aswabu, as Fudayl ibn Iyad and others from the early generations of Islam, they said, it has to be sincere for the sake of Allah, it has to be sound and correct. Right? It has to be sincere for the sake of Allah, otherwise it's not going to be accepted. If a person do the deed to other than Allah, seeking the pleasure of other than Allah, or seeking the pleasure of Allah and other than Allah. No, unless it's purely, sincerely for the sake of Allah, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, like the salah and the zakah and so on. And it has to be correct. Good intentions alone is not sufficient, unless a person follows the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that requires knowledge, whether a person has the knowledge, and there are means to seek the knowledge, very clear means, is not something that a person can invent for his own self. It's a path that is well known, which is the path of the people of knowledge, or to ask the people of knowledge. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. To ask the people of knowledge about the way of the Prophet ﷺ. So such a powerful part of the verse, that all of that is created for people to be tested. أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Who among you are the best in deeds? Something that our life should be upon this. Something that we have to constantly remind ourselves of it. That when we wake up in the morning, the attitude of a believer that has the concern, the one that really recites the Quran and reflect upon the meanings of it, he should have in his heart, how am I going to be today, by the mercy of Allah, the best among all of the human beings in actions? Is it something extremely difficult to attain? No, it's not by the mercy of Allah. It is not like the physical aspects of things. It's not like physically provisions or money or work or study. People are limited because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them limited abilities and capacities. But when it comes to matters of rewards and seeking rewards from Allah and actions, all the human beings, they have the same level of opportunity. Because if a person, for example, physically is not able to give charity, he's poor, for example, he would think that those who are wealthier than him, they surpassed him, they are better than him in deeds. The Prophet ﷺ, when the poor came to him and they complained about this matter because they understood the Quran very well and they wanted to apply it, when the poor came to the Prophet ﷺ and they said to the Prophet ﷺ, ذَهَبَ أَهْلُ الدُّثُورِ بِالْأُجُورِ, they said, O Messenger of Allah, the people of wealth, they left with the rewards, they surpassed us with the rewards. How can they be then among the best if the people of wealth, they have wealth, they pray like us, they give charity, they pray like us, they fast like us, but they have extra money. They give charity, they go for Hajj and Umrah, they do jihad fi sabilillah, and all of that requires money. So the Prophet ﷺ, he explained to them, to these poor people, as one narration said, that he taught them to do something, and if they do it, they will be in the same level as those who have physically more wealth that they will give for the sake of Allah. Something very easy and simple. He said that you تسبحون, you say Subhanallah 33 times and Alhamdulillah 33 times and Allahu Akbar 33 times after each salah. The dhikr to be said after each obligatory salah. If you do that, you will be like them. Something very easy and simple by the mercy of Allah, but at the same time many people they neglected. So to say it to perfect it, so that the person would be like those who had surpassed him with more wealth that they give for the sake of Allah. But then when the rich, they heard about this and they did the same, they made the tasbih and the takbir and the tahmid and so on, Then the poor came back to the Prophet ﷺ and they told him about this, that their brothers, those who have wealth, they did the same as the poor. And that shows how the community, the environment at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, everybody's competing to be the best, not just the poor ones because they have free or more free time, as some people think, or not just the rich ones, but everybody. So then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِي مَنْ شَاءَ. This is the bounty of Allah. He gives it to whoever He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, and He knows what He provided for each and every one of us, and what's the capacity of each person, and He knows what's in the hearts of their people, and therefore people need to be truthful with Allah, to do the best they can, and to overcome their own weaknesses and things like this. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَئِن قُلْتَ إِنَّكُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ. And that indeed that if you say, وَلَئِن قُلْتَ إِنَّكُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ, that indeed you will be مَبْعُوثُونَ, you will be resurrected, مِنْ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ, after death, لَا يَقُولَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, that the disbelievers will say, إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ, this is nothing but obvious magic. The belief of the hereafter. The messengers of Allah informed the people from the revelation of Allah about the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in the heavens and the earth with the means and the evidences that are seen clearly and is very easy to understand, that established the belief in the hereafter that can be very clear into the eyes of the people, plus the revelation from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has this power, as we heard. He's the one that is able to resurrect the people. He created them from nothing. And He's the one that informed them that He will resurrect them. And since He's not going to leave His creation without guidance, and He's the provider, and that means the resurrection or recreating them is much easier than creating them in the first place. So the disbelievers, they are in a state of arrogance, stubbornness. They're not people of intellect and reason. That's why those who deny the hereafter, they are not using their reason. They're not intellectual, but rather they are arrogant. They're stubborn. They're forgetful. They just want to enjoy themselves and not using the basic characteristics of the human being, which is the ability for them to reason things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all. So the disbelievers would say what? They just want to say something to oppose the truth. They would say this is a clear magic. What magic about this? There's no magic in it. It's not magic. It's calling the people to see the reality of things and for them to follow the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather shows the stubbornness of the disbelievers. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with the next verse after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wasalam rasulullah. Welcome back, and with verses from Surah Hud, verse number 6 to number 8, that talks about the power of Allah and the purpose of our existence, and why these signs of the power of Allah is there for people to see, why it's mentioned in the Quran, and we are reminded of the power of Allah and the creation of Allah, that He's the provider, that He's the one that knows the concealed and the apparent and everything, because we are tested. We are being tested, who among us, to be the best in actions. And the disbelievers, they deny, they disbelieve in the hereafter, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in the verse, that they would say this is obvious magic, and they contradict themselves. They're going against their own selves and their own belief and their own fitrah and nature. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that clearly in the verse. And then the next verse, verse number 8, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the disbelievers, because their stubbornness and their arrogance, and they think that they can push away the punishment from Allah when they're being warned against the punishment of Allah. The ayah says, verse number 8, وَلَئِنْ أَخَّرْنَا عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابَ إِلَىٰ أُمَّةٍ مَعْدُودَةٍ لَيَقُولُنَّ مَا يَحْبِسُ أَلَا يَوْمَ يَأْتِيهِمْ لَيْسَ مَصْرُوفًا عَنْهُمْ وَحَاقَ بِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Which means, and if we hold back from them the punishment for a limited time, they will surely say, what detains it? Unquestionably, on the day it comes to them, it will not be averted from them, and they will be enveloped by what they used to ridicule. So, وَلَئِنْ أَخَرْنَا عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابِ. And this is going to be repeated more than one verse afterwards, ولئن. And also it's mentioned in the previous one, which means an if, right? And this is something that is mentioned in the Quran for people to reflect upon its meanings. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, akharna, if we, and the noon alif at the end of the word, akharna refers to the we, and that's the royal we, and also refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels, those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send them with the punishment of Allah. So, وَلَئِنْ أَخَّرْنَا, so if we أَخَّرْنَا, if we hold back, delay, and the التأخير is to delay something, something they deserve to have it now, right, but it's delayed, right, holding back. And anything that is held back, right, it's not like in the lives of the human beings when someone wants to do something now, but he delays it because of his weakness, because of he sees something else better, there's benefit in delaying going to a place or delaying a punishment to another human being or whatever there is. Human beings, they delay things because of, they change their minds, because of weaknesses, because of things. But here to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Most High. And nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the delay here is with regards to how people, they think that the punishment has to be earlier or immediate. Even the believers, and it's mentioned throughout the Quran, the believers, the messengers of Allah, and the believers, when they see how the disbelievers are, the truth has been presented to them and the warning is given to them, and they oppose the truth and they spread evil and corruption and killing and bloodshed and so on and so forth. So the believers, they would say, Mata Nasrullah, when is the victory of Allah? And the disbelievers, they would start ridiculing the believers, as it happened to the people of Nuh. For 950 years he's calling his people, they're making mockery of him. They think that they would never be punished. The end of this would never come to place. And this is the same way that the disbelievers at all times, they look or they act as if that they would never die, as if the punishment of Allah would never come to them, because they see in their life they're given all kinds of means and wealth and power. So they think that the matter will continue. After the warning came to them, they have been warned, and the warnings in the Quran are very clear. Something that should bring the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone is living a life of sin, disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he doesn't see punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, وَلَئِنْ أَخَّرْنَا عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابِ, if we hold back the punishment, and again the significance of it is that even though they deserve it immediately, they deserve it as far as deserving is concerned, because they committed a crime, they committed evil, after the matter has been made clear to them, so that means they deserve to be punished. So why the punishment is not coming immediately? That's by the wisdom of Allah. He's the most forbearing, He's the most wise. There is wisdom behind it, and the wisdom behind that is mentioned throughout the Quran, one of which that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the previous verse, to test people with one another. And this is something that is mentioned in the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, as it's mentioned in the previous verse, and also to لِيَبْلُوَ بَعْضَكُمْ بِبَعْضٍ, to test you with one another, to test the believers by the disbelievers. The believers, they need to worship Allah with patience, with struggling. So then the disbelievers, they have power, they abuse, they do all kinds of things. So it's a test for the believers to strengthen their iman, and for the hypocrites to be distant from the believers when they see that, as it's mentioned throughout the Quran, that the hypocrites, once they see the upper hand and the power with the disbelievers and the evildoers, then they side with them, because the hypocrites are just there for their own personal physical benefit. And also it's a test for the disbelievers, because this can lead them more astray and to be more indulged into evil deeds, because they don't see punishment happening to them immediately. And as a rule, that all human beings, they really fall into this rule, and that is, if there is no uqubah, if there's no punishment, people would behave in a bad way. This is how many of the human beings, they act on the face of earth. Imagine that there's no laws that governs the lives of the human beings. In countries, for example, where there is no state of order, there is no authorities whatsoever, no punishment whatsoever, no prisons, nothing. Anybody can do whatever they want. You can imagine how chaos the life of the people would be. This is how human beings, they live their life. So the same thing when it comes to the disobedience of Allah. Since people do not see an immediate punishment in this life, what happens? Chaos becomes on the face of earth. From the disbelievers, they think that since there's no punishment, so let them disobey Allah. They might look or act like they are decent human beings when it comes to the laws of the land that the human beings themselves imposed upon one another. But when it comes to the orders of Allah, they neglect that. They're not obedient to Allah. They're disbelieving Allah. And the punishment of Allah is not an immediate one upon them, even though there are punishments that people don't see. One of which is for their hearts to be sealed. Their hearts are not seeing guidance. They're not guided upon the truth. That's the worst punishment that a person can have on the face of earth. As that meaning is established in the Quran, because the enjoyment in this life is only temporary and it's not going to be forever. So it's nothing really that people should fight for. But rather, if they are deprived from guidance, this is the real punishment, because it would lead them, if they continue and they do not repent to Allah, it would lead them to the everlasting misery, the punishment, the real punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there are great wisdom behind holding back or delaying, but it's not a delay of something that needs to be done now, but it's delayed changing the mind and so on. No, this is by the power of Allah. It's there for a reason. It's the way of Allah. So if the punishment is not happening to them immediately when they rejected the truth, right? إِلَى أُمَّةٍ مَعْدُودَ. Ummah here, it does not mean nation, because the word ummah in the Quran is mentioned in the Quran with many different meanings. One of which it means nations. It means here, as we see, limited time. So وَلَئِنْ أَخَرْنَا عَنْهُمْ عَذَابَ إِلَى أُمَّةٍ مَعْدُودَ. To a time that is counted. To a time that is counted, which is going to happen. That means the punishment is not, you know, cancelled, or they're not going to be punished. No, they are going to be punished. But it's only, the matter is not immediate one, but it's after some time. And it's in a specific time, limited time, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most wise. So the disbelievers, out of their arrogance and ignorance, they would say, لَا يَقُولُنَّ مَا يَحْبِسُ. They would say, what detains it? What is preventing your Lord from punishing us? This is how arrogant they would say. The messengers of Allah are warning them. The righteous ones are calling them, fear Allah, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, save yourself from the hellfire. The same thing when they are calling people to stay away from sins. This is what we as Muslims, we should enjoin good and forbid evil. When we see sins are being widespread, when we see people neglecting the orders of Allah, Muslims not making their salah, or committing major sins and being neglectful about the orders of Allah, we should warn. We should give also glad tidings, as it's mentioned in the Quran. The way of the Quran should be presented, and not just to say things that religion is just about manners and good things and so on. We have to be sincere towards others, that when a person lead a life of a sin, life of sin, sins, disobeying Allah, forgetful, what's waiting is a dangerous one, unless they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them. So warning them that yes, you might not be punished in the sense of physical punishment in this life, right? But the punishment is coming for those who disobey Allah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. So save yourself from the punishment of Allah. Turn away from your own destroying your own self, and don't be like the disbelievers, those who would say, why the punishment is being detained? Why there is no punishment? Shaitan would whisper unto the person. Shaitan would say to the people that, well, since you're not punished and you're living a life of sin, that means you're okay. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even is pleased with you. Because the more you sin, the more He provides for you. And Allah is the provider, so how would He provide to a sinner? This is how human beings, they think in a wrong way. They think without seeking guidance from the Quran. This is their own deficiency and weakness, because this is how human beings, they might interact with one another. Someone is not being nice to you, you're not going to continue to be extremely nice to him. This is how human beings, they might act, because of their weakness. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us in the Quran that the ways of Allah is different than the ways of the human beings. So this can be very deceiving to them. So that's why when we read the Quran, that saves us from this deception. So they would say, what detains them? أَلَا يَوْمَ يَأْتِيهِمْ لَيْسَ مَصْرُوفًا عَنْهُمْ وَحَاقَ بِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns that when the punishment comes, even though it's to them, it seems like it's delayed, but it's not delayed, but it's by specific limited measures by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the time of the punishment comes, لَيْسَ مَصْرُوفًا عَنْهُمْ, it would never be averted from them. And مَصْرُوفًا, in that way that it's been established linguistically, gives that meaning that it's not a matter of action that it's going to happen. It's a done deal. It's something that is well established in the meaning. It's not going to be averted from them. And more, وَحَاقَ بِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا بِيَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. And what they used to ridicule, the believers, the orders of Allah, the, the ways of the messenger, all of these means of ridiculing the truth will envelop them, will surround them. That means their actions will surround them. That means they will be seized. There's no way out for them. They will be punished by the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of their own evil actions. Such a powerful verse and verses that talks about the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, the power of Allah. And that for people not to be deceived, and we see how guidance in the Quran gives this tranquility in the hearts of the believers, because many people, they don't know these meanings. They do not know the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. And people think, again, as we said before, they do all kinds of evil things. They oppose the orders of Allah. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order the human beings to do? To worship Him alone, not to associate partners with Allah. How many people associate partners with Allah on the face of earth when the message had reached them and the matter become clear to them? That when it comes to the matters of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sins that are widespread, that people know that these are sins, neglecting the salah, committing zina wal'ayadhu billah, drinking intoxicants, dealing with riba, usury, and all kinds of evil things, stealing, bribery, lying, backbiting, all kinds of things that is every day. How many of these sins are being established and done on the face of earth when people still continue to be in the state of forgetfulness, thinking there's no punishment, that means it's never going to happen. And the way they are living in this life, it's going to continue after this life. Who said that? The unseen is being revealed to us from the verses of the Quran. That this is, you are living in a limited time. And this limited time, you are left to do whatever you want. Yes, it might seem to be this way, but there is an end to this. There's an end to this life. And we see that also with our own eyes, and we hear it every day. Hundreds and thousands of people are dying, and it's a turn. Everybody's taking their turn, and nobody knows when he's going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, a person should be wise and should not be deceived, as many people are deceived, that since there's no punishment, they think that there's no punishment. No, the punishment is coming. أَلَا يَوْمَ يَأْتِيهِمْ When the day of it will come. When is the punishment of Allah comes or starts? The physical punishment for those who are not punished in this world is the moment of death. Once a person starts that journey in the hereafter, for the disbelievers, then it's a misery after misery afterwards. And for the sinners, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them, it's the moment of death. That is much sooner than what all of us think. And the punishment of Allah, nobody will be able to avert it, because He's the most powerful. He's the one that is able to do all things. And those who ridicule and those who waste their life in this, it would surround them, their actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just and He's the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the time to repent to Allah and to seek forgiveness, as it's mentioned in the beginning of the verse. And it's something that we will carry throughout the surah, that an istaghfiru rabbakum thumma tubu ilayh. Seek forgiveness from your Lord and repent to Him. And then more evidences and more stories of the nations and things like this. For what? For us to return back to the beginning of the surah. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Seek forgiveness from Him. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before all of these things, as we would hear and as we hear, that is going to happen, and it will happen by the will of Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the punishment of Allah and to make us all source of guidance to others, and for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide the people and to guide the believers to be steadfast on the deen of Allah. Until next time, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa sallamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام